He's slowly. He's good size. You know what? He might be a hitchhiker, okay. because you saw those little taps.
Yeah, I did.
I think that was a rockfish.
Yeah, you had hooked one, and then all of a sudden, the thing was loaded up.
Yeah.
So in the past, whenever I've caught a lingcod, I've always thrown away the head and the carcass. I do what most lazy anglers do. I keep the fillet and toss the rest, and I've learned that that's a bad idea. There's a lot of value in the head. Not only can you get at the cheeks, but you can boil the head down and turn it into an awesome fish head soup. So in a past video, I've shown you how to take out the cheeks, how to saute them, and they actually taste fantastic. They taste a lot like scallops.
It tastes like a scallop.
If not, you know, even better. They're a little more tender, and they're just fantastic. Probably the best part of the entire fish. Now, a sub out of Oahu, Hawaii gave me a great suggestion, Una Outdoors. Hopefully I'm pronouncing that right, Ian. He said that when they catch their personal best uluas, or grand chevalis, or GTs for short, they actually keep the jaw bones and preserve them as trophies of their PB catches. And I thought, hey, why not do that to this lingcod? You know, the lingcod's not huge by West Coast standards, but for California, a 13-pound lingcod's a good size. They get up to about 30 in these waters, but, I mean, you know, in Alaska, you can catch them up to 70 pounds. But this was, you know, a good-sized one, and I decided to give it a shot. Now, I've never preserved, you know, bones before for any kind of animal. I'm not a taxidermist. I'm not a hunter, so I'm not really familiar with how to preserve bones. But using common sense, I wanted to do it as easy as possible, as cheap as possible, and I wanted to do it as green as possible. I didn't want to deal with any chemicals. So it started with my mom. I gave her the lingcod head to make fish head soup. And as I mentioned in a previous vid, a lingcod head isn't an entire skull. It's a collection of bones and cartilage and muscle, and you boil it all down, and essentially it melts down into a stew. Now, to get to the bones that you want to keep, you have to ladle out all the bones and the cartilage pieces. So you have to hand select all the mandibles that you want to keep, any of the nasal cavities that you want to keep. And you got to be really careful not to break the teeth out of the lower jaw and the upper jaw, because they become pretty fragile once you start stripping away all that cartilage and all that meat. So I pulled out what I thought would make the mandibles or what would make a good preserved set. And I took it out, let them dry for a little bit. How did I do this on the cheap without any chemicals? ANTS. That's right, ANTS. I use nature's favorite little cleaners to clean out the bones for me. I took the remaining mandible pieces and I put them in a have-a-heart rat cage and set it outside near an anthill for a whole month. The reason why I kept it in a cage was to keep other critters from running away with the bones or gnawing on them. And, it only took a couple days for the ANTS to find the bones and really get into it. I mean, the ANTS did a great job. Not only did they clean away the significant amounts of meat that were stuck to the bone, but they removed all the tiny bits of flesh in between all the tiny teeth. And by doing it this way, by not scrubbing each individual teeth with a toothbrush or something like that, I was able to preserve like 95% of all the teeth in the mandible structure. Once you strip away all that meat, once you introduce a high temperature, everything just wants to fall apart. So I thought, why not let nature do it? Nature knows best, and I let her do her thing. And if you give her enough time, you're left with this. A completely cleaned out lingcod mouth, basically. The lingcod mouth that you're looking at here came from a 13-pound lingcod. A 13-pound lingcod, again, isn't as big as they get on the California West Coast. You know, I've seen guys catch them in the 20 to 30-pound range, so imagine a 30-pound mandible, it'd be like this big. But still, 13 pounds is pretty impressive. And if you've ever seen a lingcod mouth on a live lingcod, it's pretty intimidating. With all the flesh removed, they're even more scary. I mean, I never realized how many teeth were actually in a lingcod jaw. This jaw is actually comprised of three main pieces along with a nasal cavity. The top mandible is actually comprised of two bones on each side. I caught the lower ones because they were obvious because they had all these teeth, but there's actually two main ones that accompany the top here. They make up kind of the top of the lingcod mouth. This is pretty cool. I mean, look at the little plates here that make up the bottom mandible. Just imagine, you know, the muscles that get tied from the cheeks into these lower jaws. I mean, these are opportunistic hunters. They sit and lie in wait in reefs. They only move like 7 to 10 feet per day, I've heard. And they're ambush predators. They lay in wait, they come up, and with these powerful jaws and many, many teeth, they grab onto slippery bait fish. Take a look at how many teeth are in this jaw. I mean, it's just amazing. I've never seen this many teeth in an animal before. It really reminds me of those sharks we've all seen growing up. Ragged tooth sharks, bull sharks, great whites, of course. You know, nature just, you know, allows the lingcod to grow teeth nonstop all through its lifetime. I think it just never runs out of teeth. They just keep growing and growing and growing and replacing each other as they fall out. Pretty amazing. I mean, I'm geeking out pretty hard over all this stuff, and I'm not really into animal bone structure like, you know, a lot of people are. Just fantastic. I kept the nasal cavity because I wanted to give some kind of reference for, you know, what the top and maybe kind of center of the snout looked like in relation to the fish. So if you can kind of imagine, here's its mouth, you know, the cheek would be about here, the nasal ports would be about here, and the eyeballs are centered kind of high, they'd be about here. Just pretty cool. I'm really happy with the way this came out. To put it together, again, there's really only four pieces, the lower mandible, the two top separate mandible pieces that make the top jaw, and the nasal bone here. You know, I don't even think this is bone. I think this is cartilage right here. And I just hot glued it together here. You can kind of see where the hot glue is in the light, how it's shining there. Hot glued those two pieces. And for the hinges, for the, you know, top and bottom mandible pieces, just use a lot more hot glue and actually paperclip pieces. Just wanted something simple, something cheap. The hot glue actually does a fantastic job of adhering to the bone or the cartilage here because this stuff is so porous. As soon as you hit it with the hot glue, it just stays pretty tight. And the great thing about hot glue is if you make a mistake or if the bend in the paperclips isn't working out for you, you can just reapply the tip of the hot glue gun to soften it, and you can slowly reposition the bones around the paperclip. But super cheap way to you know, put this together. And altogether, you know, to preserve this mouth here cost me exactly $0. You know, just a little bit of hot water, a little bit of sunlight, and a lot of patience and a bunch of ants. That's what it took to get me here. Oh, and a paperclip and a, you know, quarter stick of hot glue. That's it. So yeah, just something I wanted to share with you guys, something a little bit out of the norm. I'm really happy that that sub, you know, Una Outdoors, gave me the suggestion. I definitely look forward to doing this on bigger catches in the future for all kinds of species. If you are familiar with the preservation process of fish bones like this, let me know in the comments below. If you have a more professional way of doing this, but I think this turned out pretty darn good. I might give this a spray and coat of bleach first, let it air dry, and then maybe cover it in acrylic just to keep everything preserved and everything kind of locked in. But otherwise, I mean, I think it turned out pretty darn cool. What do you think? Is this something you'd be interested in doing in the future for your future catches? Leave me a comment in the section below. I definitely look forward to doing this for future catches, especially that big 30-pound lingcod. So thanks again for watching. Hopefully you enjoyed, and I'll see you guys in the next one.